Hey, this is Sasha, and welcome to another episode of Let's Talk Stocks, episode number 174. Today, we'll talk a little bit about the market news. So we have some tariffs that we'll discuss. We'll look at Gary Cohn here, and just overall what's going on here coming up with the jobs report as well. So these are kind of some of the bigger news topics that have happened in the market, and those are the ones we'll talk about. And then towards the last half of the video, we'll also be covering some stocks. I'll cover SPX, Netflix, McDonald's, Shop, Western Digital, Microsoft, and Lowe's. At least those will be the main focus. So let's take a look at some of these news headlines here, what's going on. Here's our episode 174 that we're going to be working on. First main thing is really the tariffs that Trump is enacting. And when you really look at the tariffs between the steel and aluminum that he's passed, you have to kind of look at some of the old tariffs that also have played out, such as the Obama tariffs in 2009, look at the Bush steel tariffs in 2002. So these are kind of some of the things that have gained some ground in the past, or we've had some history behind them that's also recent. And what's important to note is when you look at tariffs overall, it's basically you're looking to put some taxes on things. Now, where you want to win out in certain areas, you can win. You can easily make your money in steel and aluminum and get a lot more money as people are bringing in those goods into your country. And you may think that that's a great thing, and that is if you want to save a certain sector or a certain industry, but you can't do it for everything, right? You can't get tariffs for steel and aluminum and also raise tariffs for avocados and raise tariffs for tires and raise tariffs for everything. It just doesn't work that way, not in a global economic way. So if you plan to win the steel and aluminum tariff and get that, that's fine. But it's a give and get kind of situation where that means, well, you might actually start paying more for other things that are coming into your country and vice versa. So that's typically what happens with these tariffs. And usually, if you've ever read the book Stephen Covey, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, usually what you want is a win-win situation. When you just all of a sudden impose something on someone, hey, why don't you do this? It's very difficult for countries to react. Just like as a sane person, when you say, hey, why don't you go ahead and do this? This is what you need to be eating right now. So imagine you going to a restaurant and someone saying, hey, no, this is what you're going to eat. All of a sudden you look at the waitress and say, hey, why are you telling me this? You know, I came here, I want to look at the menu and I want to decide. But this is really what ends up happening is that, you know, you could say it's unfair, but this is really what's happening when it comes to tariffs is that we impose something, other countries are going to impose other things as well. It's just normal and natural. You're not going to just get everything you want because it's like asking, you know, a little kid, I want this, I want this, I want cereal, I want candy, I want chocolate, I want ice cream. You're not going to get everything that you want. And the same thing with these tariffs. You might get these tariffs, that's fine. You'll make it in tariffs as far as steel and aluminum goes, but you might lose out and hurt many more industries. So you might win out steel and aluminum and these sectors, but you might lose out in five other places. So you win two, you lose five. Now, it may be that you only lose in one of other places, but in either case, you're not gonna just keep, you know, gaining ground because other countries won't put up with it. Anyways, so that's just kind of my thought and take on tariffs. And these things usually move slow, so it's not like we'll see things right away because even these kinds of tariffs haven't fully been written down on paper yet, with Canada now and Mexico maybe getting a 30-day leeway. So all this kind of goes around in hoopla and circles. With that being said, just like going around in circles, you have Gary Cohn here that left. So you have that revolving door that happens at the White House where people come in and people go out. I think, you know, if you look at Trump and the way that the White House is being run, because obviously he's at the top, so he is running it and you run the operation. Granted, he's not always doing the hiring and the firing. Sometimes it's other people doing the hiring and the firing. And in this case, you know, Gary Cohn left, he resigned, right? It wasn't that he was fired. He resigned, But it's that revolving door. If you have an output a certain energy, not saying or discrediting or putting a huge negative emphasis on Trump, it's just that the energy that he has is just there's a revolving and rotating energy to him, which also, if you look at his staff, the way that he runs things, how many secretaries has he had? How many people just constantly rotate that are there? There's no consistency and stability overall in the employment side. Same thing here, whether it's he does the firing or people are resigning, people are constantly rotating. If you look at his personal life and the relationships and the marriages that he's had, the women constantly rotate. And that's just the energy that he outputs. So I wouldn't be surprised if we get more rotation with, throughout the rest of his career in the White House for however long he stays. Other than that, really, when you look at the market, the way that it played out was this guy resigned. The market shrugged it off a little bit because, well, they're getting used to the revolving door. They're getting used to the movement in the White House. But I have to say that a lot of people did like Gary Cohn in terms of him being, the Goldman Sachs kind of person and a little bit more stable-minded, looking for a vision within the economics, and a lot of people liked them. So that kind of took the market by surprise. They didn't like it as much, but it did happen, and eventually, towards the end of the day, we did come back. Overall, is it a good thing, bad thing? I mean, I thought he was probably a good voice in the White House, but you never really know who's coming up next, and probably that job will get replaced again once or twice. Who knows? Once the rotations start, they typically keep going, right? So, anyway, so these are a couple of the main headlines here. The other big thing to watch is the jobs report that we have coming out, I believe, here on Friday, which is tomorrow at 8:30 in the morning. We have the jobs report. We already have the ADP number. So keep an eye on how this plays out when you look at the jobs report. We're in a very low unemployment rate. Now keep in mind that there's a different number when we look at the job market here. There's actually a different number that you want to also look for. Let me just pull it up for you. And here's what took me a minute here to pull up this metric, the U6 unemployment rate. So basically, the unemployment rate that is official is the U3, is the official unemployment rate. U5 includes discouraged workers and all other marginally attached workers. And the U6 adds on those workers who are part-time purely for economic reasons. The current U6 unemployment rate is at 8.20. So basically, they take the most favorable number, the U3, and use that as unemployment. Really, there's the U6 also and U5 as well for people who don't really want to work. U5, they're discouraged. I'm pissed off at my company. I don't want to deal with this stuff. For whatever reason. Then you have the current the U6 unemployment rate as well, which adds on who are part-time that have to be, at least they need money. So the reality is that even though here unemployment, the official here, we're at what is it, 4.1, the U5 is really at 5, and the normal unemployment is really at about 8. So when we were kind of at, let's say, the 2009 there, unemployment was around 9%, but really it was at 17. Think about that, 17%, 20% of the country was unemployed. So that's why you had that recession. But this is how they skew the numbers. So just understand that, they're looking for these numbers to be better, right? Better, better, better. And just understand that the numbers that are reported are the favorable numbers. They're the nice numbers. So take a look at the jobs report, but always things are underneath the surface than really what they are or what they show you. So that's the other thing to take a look at on Friday that's coming up. So just watch how the market reacts, because you could have a great jobs number and the market sells off. You could have a great job number and the market pops. It really just depends on sentiment. Depends then, hey, well, does that mean the Federal Reserve increases the speed of their rising interest rates? So all these things could play in. So whatever the number is, just watch the market reaction. Don't stress about what the number is, because even then it'll be somewhat in alignment, and it's only one report out of, let's look at the next four or the next five and see what the trend is. Are we continuing to rise that unemployment, or is it decreasing the unemployment? So look over the last four or the next four, and that's what you want to do. As for looking at some stock charts, let's start out with the S&P, and if we take a look at it, we're down about 50 cents right now. We're just kind of isolating in this little range. Not much is happening after we got this little pop right here. We had some highs at around 2800, so we're kind of isolating, digesting this big sell-off pressure over here. Overall, we'll see how this evolves. If we struggle a little more, there's nothing that says you can't come back to retest things, because again, there's these tariffs coming in, the trade wars could be coming in. And the trade war isn't going to be that bad. It sounds bad, but it could be just, hey, well, we'll tax, just like the EU announced, we'll tax Levi's jeans, Harley-Davidson, we'll tax the bourbon, the whiskeys, those kinds of things. So, but these create some things of uncertainty. So anyways, so this is why you get more sell-offs throughout certain years than others, is when you had such an extension, now you need time for digestion. Taking a look at Netflix, this thing just continued to power higher, continues to run. We're up at around 320 now. A little bit of resistance there, I would assume, or profit taking that should happen here. But this stock's just a monster. Just broke out here, past the 300. After the 300, I talked about that, and boom, continued to run. Again, this was our support level right here. Counter bounced. Stock's doing well. Volume also picking up right there. So it looks good for higher prices. If you look at the weekly, I think we're stretched. I mean, this is euphoria a little bit, but this thing could still go $400 or $500 and then get a pullback, because when you look at the moving average, we're lagging. But this is one of the best performing stocks out there. Looking at McDonald's here, this one, if you're looking for a longer term play, it's holding a little bit at this support level, which was right here in June 2017. So we're trying to get a bounce. For the time being, I'd watch and be careful around the 160. That could be a little bit of resistance, and also this moving average as it starts to creep up. So the key question is, are we going to head here and reject, or are we going to, just continue higher, bounce kind of, and move into upper prices? So again, those are some things to kind of keep an eye on. Shopify over here broke this 140 level. Okay, volume is starting to pick up a little bit. So far it looks good. If we can break the 150 again, it should be going higher after that. But if we get a little pullback and you get a bounce at the 140, this is going to be real nice, and then you get a nice kind of bounce. The 140 is key, your line in the sand. That's where your support is. If you want to have a stop, 139, let's say 15, could be a nice level, giving it an extra dollar right there. Otherwise, so far looks good. Continues to run after breaking out right there. Western Digital, also real nice right here when you look at the descending trend line. I'm not sure if I can even draw it. There it is. Descending trend line breaking out here, volume picking up. You also have some other resistance levels right here horizontally that are breaking out. Looks good. And it's approaching the $100 level. Okay. So as you start looking at this, you start backing it up and you see, okay, well, what do we do around those price points? So you can see right here, it may even be creating an A to B, B to C, C to D pattern, which would almost put it right back to that $120 level. But we'll see, time will tell. Volume is slightly picking up. That's for the long term. But here is really what you're watching, the resistance. And so far, this stock is now starting to break out. 120 could be a little bit of trouble right there because it's already moved. But if we get above 120, the next level to watch is kind of this. Not 120. If we get above the 100 and then get into the 100 level, we are going to want to watch the 112 level, 112, 113 level. That's where there's some resistance. So right now we're breaking the 95 and we're getting into the 100. So you're looking for it to break the 100. If we break the 100, some resistance at the 111, 112, 113 level. Microsoft, double top. Triple top now. So here you could see here's resistance right here. little more resistance coming up. Stock continues to move higher since this 85 swing point getting in. We'll see if we can break right here past that 95 level. If we can, should continue moving higher. If we can't and we break below this, could be a nice shorting opportunity, but you do have some nice support levels right here. So if you're shorting, it's going to be for a couple of dollars, not going to be for a long time. 91, 90 is kind of key, but really 91.50 is a nice support level right there where these couple of swing points were at. Okay. Of course, you'll watch the 90. That's a nice round number. And if we really get bad, 85. But right now, looking for a potential breakout as well. Unfortunately, the volume, you know, is decreasing slightly, and you can see we have overhead resistance. So, you know, I'm not sure if we're going to really pop higher on a lot of stocks here. We'll see. Because again, watch the S&P, it's moving kind of sideways. You know, we're not pushing higher. We're getting a little like watch here, massive sell off, slight push higher, right? It's only went about halfway, massive selling. And now again, only about halfway or 60-70% of what we sold off. So now what's going to happen? Well, you don't know. You could get, again, a next leg down and further selling and get halfway. Or here's the other approach, of course. Well, you digest, and all of a sudden you pop. You could get some resistance here, little pullback, and a break higher. So again, kind of there's a couple of opportunities here of where are we going to break. You don't know right here because the market's kind of in digestion mode and it's trying to figure out a direction with, you know, the jobs report, you got the tariff thing, you got Gary Cohn leaving. So, you know, overall, normally markets move higher as you look at the chart. But when you start evaluating for the shorter term, well, can we come back to retest? Maybe, maybe not. But I think right here, we're creating some of these lower highs still. So here's our kind of our new slight trend line that I'm starting to watch right there. So anyways, with Microsoft too, right now we're still rejecting this price point, and it just means that it could take a little longer for it to break out. And then finally, if we look at lows here, it's coming into a nice potential support level right here. So if we get into the weekly, you can see here we have a resistance level, and then that means that's our support. So we had some big selling coming back into the 85, kind of similar to the 110 was up here, and now we're at 85. So real nice value opportunity compared to the recent prices. It's kind of like the Walmart effect, right? So you're looking at the Walmart, which was at 110, and now it's back to kind of 87. So again, allowing you to buy these stocks at cheaper prices. I think 80 would be more favorable, but doesn't mean you can't slowly start nibbling a little bit of shares. If you look at the daily, you can see it's still selling pressure right at the 200 day right there. But overall, fairly big haircut here. So coming back right into this, and even at the 80, could be nice, but already fairly nice pullback since that breakout earlier in October, November of last year. So anyways, those are just kind of my thoughts as far as the overall market goes. I hope you enjoyed this video. Keep an eye out for those jobs numbers because that'll probably dictate which way the market moves tomorrow. Overall, I think we're just still in a digestion period. So we'll see which way things either move to the upside or the downside. We'll also see how these things with the tariffs implement and if any countries tend to retaliate, which some are probably already thinking about in which ways to do that and strategically mapping these things out. And I think it's good for when a company wants to look at its strategy that it wants to use within combating some tariffs. So they don't want to make emotional decisions. I think here, especially with the current administration, we tend to make a lot of emotional decisions rather than thinking about logical things and basing it on the numbers and what's worked and what hasn't. And that's great if you want to protect a certain industry, but there's a give and take. So anyways, I thank you so much for joining me in this video. I hope you enjoyed the video content and thank you so much for sticking with me. If you've gotten the passive dividend investing course over the last month, hope you're enjoying that video and be sure to reach out to me if you have any questions with any of the material, whether that's on the courses that we have or even on any questions that you may have on about charts, trading, or maybe the economic world. Thanks for joining me, and remember to hit the subscribe button right down here if you want to get updates and announcements for when I release new videos. But best of all, make sure to sign up to the newsletter list over here. When you get on that newsletter list, we send announcements weekly on any new videos that we release and any new courses, materials, products, sales, or any discounts. So thanks again for joining me. Remember, do what you love, contribute to other people, but most importantly, live life abundantly. I'll see you in the next video.